are with Arthur Hewlett, co-founder of Mars One, and Philip Lam, the founder of Iron Orbit Space Consultants. I hope you will enjoy this last battle, and I think we can start. So, Eric, to start, you have a space consultancy called Iron Orbit. Maybe for some people it isn't very clear what a space consultancy is. Maybe you can clarify that a little bit.
Okay, what I do with my, I have a freelancing company, Iron Orbit. So what I do, I give advice to the international space industry on technical matters, on policy matters. So yeah, I help out, for example, Airbus, one of the biggest space companies in the world. I do sometimes work with ESTEC, NORAD, that's the facility of the European Space Agency. So when I do some things for companies, then I normally work for the European Space Agency a lot. And next to that, I do outreach and communication events.
Excellent. Maybe you have some potential astronauts in the public right now. So you're co-founder of Mars One, this company that wants to put people on Mars. Can you maybe explain how far are you in this project? How is it? What are your goals with the company?
So we started Mars One in 2011 after 2 years of preparation, because we understand how complex and how difficult a project like this is. So what we did is we came with the idea around 2009, bus travel basically around the world to talk with all the major aerospace companies like Lockheed Martin, like Boeing, and SpaceX, to discuss basically what is possible from a hardware point of view. Are the plans we had in mind, are they actually feasible within the time frame we had in mind? So this is what we did. After a year, we found out that most of the companies said that they were able to deliver the hardware we would need. So with that information, we went to the founder of Big Brother, and we asked him, would he see any financial ways to make such a mission possible? So we had a long discussion in that show, and he told us, yeah, if you can make it technically feasible, we think that we can make it financially as well. But that was for us the trigger to say, okay, let's go further in this and set up Mars One. Now, of course, there is a huge amount of work which needs to be done to make such a mission possible. And there's a huge amount of risk that such a mission will not happen. So we worked very hard. We have lots of setbacks. And currently we're at the stage where there is money in the company. We have a shop of a stock exchange in Germany, in Frankfurt. We're shortlisted there. So things are progressing, but in a very slow pace at the moment. But we're still there, and we still want to do this. Of course, the timeline we projected in 2011 has now changed, because you have to adapt, it's a simple. So now the aim is to do it around 2033.
So, and why did you want to go to Mars? Largest planet instead of Earth?
For us, it's the most logical place to go to for the human race, if you want to go to a different place in our solar system. We think that the Moon is not sufficient enough with respect to resources. Mars has much more. Water, but also others. So from a resource point of view, but also from a environmental point of view, we think that Mars is more suitable for human life than any other place in our solar system.
And more from an ideological standpoint, why would you even want to leave Earth? Like, what are the reasons that people are attracted to this idea of colonization of this new planet?
For me, it's the logical expansion of humanity. It's very simple. So we have been working on Earth for a very long time. And what we see now is that the solar system is not a closed system with respect to Earth. Earth is part of the solar system. If you want to make sure that humanity survives for a long duration, you have to understand this. So you have to understand what the asteroids are doing. You have to understand what are the other planets, how planets evolve. And for me, the most logical way to do that is to send humans not only to Mars, because that would be the only start, but you have to go to the moons of Jupiter, the moons of Saturn. That's long term. We have to populate the solar system. And not only with respect to expanding, but also with respect to the resources which are available. The solar system is a huge reservoir of resources which are basically there for humanity to use.
And Erik, why do you want to go to Mars?
Why do I want to go to Mars? Well, firstly, I would like to go, but also to come back again. And not just on a one-way trip and live there for the rest of my short life, but then come back again. But yeah, why I go to Mars? I think it's a very simple answer, because it's there, and it's technically possible to go there. So that's my reason. And I'm just fascinated. I was born after the moon landing, so I'm an orphan of Apollo, but I've seen the pictures. And that was just an inspiration for me to work in the space business. They look at these people, they walked on the moon. And that, yeah, just inspires me. It touches me somewhere that I think, yeah, this is great. And I think the next place, destiny for people is Mars. That's the next trip. So let's go, yeah.
It's part of human nature.
Yeah, I think it's part of human nature, yeah.
So, but so we Arno also already said that Mars is also, it's the most ideal place to go from a standpoint of technical challenges that need to be overcome. Could you maybe specify what makes Mars such an ideal place? Like, what are the characteristics that are very favorable for us to go there?
I would first say that it's just the most accessible planet from Earth, but it's far from habitable now. It's not, I would say, a friendly place. You should compare it to Antarctica, and then Antarctica without atmosphere almost.
Yeah.
So it's not. Yeah, there is a lot of things to overcome to go there, but these are, I think, technical feasible. It's just a matter of putting the priority there, and I think the way to go to Mars. I mean, Mars One, of course, wants to go there in a commercial way. And I think the only way you can finance it commercially is to say, we're going one way. We're going there and not bring them back. And what I think now, that governments that also say they want to go to Mars, somehow they cannot sell it to the taxpayer that their astronauts will go one way and not come back. So they will have to develop the system to go back again, but also have the finance to do that, because that's the major hurdle, to finance to have the astronauts come back again.
Yes, so you're already talking a little bit about what the technical problems are. So in the next piece, we want to dig a little bit deeper into it. So. What you're saying is that now it's already theoretically possible to actually get there.
Yes.
But coming back is more of the problem.
But that's technical, that's also feasible technically.
Yeah.
You just need a lot of equipment to send into space, you need a lot of launching stuff, you need to construct things in space, so there's a lot of work to be done.
Yes.
Arno, can you explain how we are going there with the rocket and everything, what is needed to go there?
Sure. There, like Erik is saying, is that you need a large amount of equipment to make sure that people who are going there are able to sustain and able to live there. So you need to develop landing systems, you need to develop spacecraft who are able to bring you from Earth to Mars. Life support systems, which need to be very well developed such that they can make sure that humans survive for a very long time. And all these things need to be developed. But what we're saying is that the essence, so the technical essence which is needed to make these systems, that is known. Everybody knows how to do this. We now need to make sure that those technical essences are being put into the systems which are really needed. And there were, I think, a lot have been made possible now for the last 10 years, because we see a big increase in the capabilities of material sciences, rocket propulsion and stuff like that. A very good example what you really need to bring people to Mars is a system which is under rocket propulsion so that you can land properly and not by airbags, which is being done by the science missions. You need to land people in a proper way. And this kind of rocket technology is basically being tested now by SpaceX and Elon Musk when he's relighting his first stage to get back to Earth. It's in the same regime of plasma physics and speed, like a mission to Mars where you have to land. So all these, this was a very major piece of technology which wasn't there 10, 15 years ago, but it's now basically there. So we see that within the companies, but also within NASA and ESA, we see a lot of technology developments which are gearing us to make sure that the systems which are required to go there will become available in a short amount.
So you just mentioned that landing is difficult, and we have done a few investigations about it. But can you also tell us how we even like go there? So the rocket and what you need, which equipment is there for? How do you do it?
So what you basically need is a rocket like the Falcon Heavy from SpaceX. You launch that two or three times to bring everything in low Earth orbit. You connect them, like was done in the missions to the Moon, and then you send the spacecraft off to Mars. And what you do is, in between, you already send equipment, but also habitats to Mars. Without humans involved, and they land there automatically, and they are basically prepared there on Mars. And then, only then, will you send humans to Earth. So you have to make sure that 80 to 90% of equipment which is needed to make sure that humans are able to survive on Mars is already there before you launch. That's what we say, and we have to make sure that a mission to Mars is already very risky, and you have to make sure that you limit the risk as much as you can by making sure that everything is already working before you launch the humans.
So what I understand from this is that a lot of the technical capabilities are already there. So what is stopping us? What is taking so much time? Is it economic? Is it just time needed to develop all these systems?
Well, if you ask NASA and ESA to come up with a cost estimate for a human mission to Mars with people bringing back, so you bring the people back, there are numbers ranging between $100 billion and $500 billion. There is no way that the US government is going to support any of this. There's just not the budget. But they're not going to do this. The only way you might be able to do this is when you send people one way. Like Eric already said, from a political point of view, you cannot propose anything like this. You cannot send government employees to a planet and then tell them we're not bringing you back. So for me, a mission to Mars will not be done by ESA or NASA within the next 50 to 60 years, because the budget is just not there.
Can I interrupt a bit? One of the things I find hard to understand is why that is. Why is a government, why can a government not send a person to Mars on a one-way ticket? What's the reason? I mean, the person is not being forced, he or she is not being forced. So, it's not coming back. So, there's some kind of ethical discussion which I don't understand why a government cannot do that. But I hear the same stories that, I mean, ESA, talking to the scientists at the European Space Agency, they say, yeah, this is really non-ethical, to send people to their death. Yeah. And somehow assuming people have infinite life, which they haven't. They will die here on Earth also. But there's somewhere, something I don't understand. I don't know if you have a view on that.
Well, the thing is that I think most of the governments involved are quite conservative. If you look to the parties involved, like in the US, they're very conservative governments, mostly also based on quite a deep religious as well. So what we understand much better now is that there is a strong, like you say, ethical reasoning of not allowing people to make decisions in their own life. This is what we strongly see everywhere. So people don't want you to go to the Mount Everest and to climb there and to die on the mountain. This is also more and more not becoming accepted as a norm. So there is a problem in Western society, from my point of view, with risk taking. we are not allowed to take any risks anymore. And we're not allowed to decide for ourselves what we do with our lives. Being restricted more and more. And I think this is a major issue, which either we tackle quite quickly, or other countries will run away with the technology that we have within 10 years.
So, to understand better, you're saying that we should maybe take more risks in sending people around, but I don't know, we don't want to put human lives on the line, is that not something that
The moment, the thing is what people don't realize is that the moment you put people on a rocket, that's where you already risk your life. If the rocket blows up, you're dead. It's a very simple story. So you're already taking risks. We need to make sure that the risk we take is worth it. So going to Mars from my point of view is worth taking the risk.
But do you think people can like oversee the consequences of their choice?
Because of course they can. You have to. Let me tell you a story about the people we have currently in our last 100 who applied for going to Mars. When we started this application program in 2012, we received 200,000 people applying for going to Mars. And of course, you get a lot of people who don't really understand what they're applying for. You get lots of nutcases as well. This is normal. But now we're back to 100, and most of the people there have a very high education. They clearly understand the risks they're taking.
Yeah, but they can understand the risk, but also oversee the consequences, because when they're there, and they change their mind, for example, or they want to go back, well, there's no way.
Yeah, but it's very simple, you cannot change your mind. So you need to be dedicated. It's simple, if you are halfway to the mountain, the top of the Mount Everest, you cannot change your mind either. You're there.
So then you can be rescued.
No, there's almost no rescue. People die continuously.
But there's almost no rescue, and if you're in Mars, then there's no technical way you can go back. That's, I feel
different. This is what people understand. Those people who won't send them just after applying and then just let them go, they will be trained for at least 8 to 10 years before we send them off. So people will have the capability to decide not to go anyway between now and the actual launch. So we will not train only 4 people. The plan is to train 5 times 4 people, because if someone drops out, the whole team will be out. But it's very simple. But people do understand the risks they're taking, and they also understand what they're trying to achieve. Right? There are people who applied who said that if we would have offered the way back as well, they would not have applied. This is a very different mindset than people like you and me have. I'm not like that as well, don't get me wrong. But there are people who have this, I call it the old pioneering spirit, and are willing to do whatever it takes to do something unique, which brings them further. It's a different mindset.
But, okay, I understand what you mean, but if we look at it realistically, do you see the political views changing on this matter in the coming years, or do we just have to look at other ways to not one way ticket, but also take it back?
For me, it either works one way or it won't work. I don't see at the moment any political will in any place in the world which is willing to take the right amount of budget there to do a mission like that and to bring people back. So I don't think within our lifetimes that it would happen like that, unless we see a major technological progress, like warp drive or whatever, which will make sure that you can go there in much faster ways. But I don't see that at the moment.
But do you think the political views will change then?
I don't think so. I think for a long time it will be like this, and the only way this is going to happen is either by a commercial company, with help of governments. Yeah. Governments are always involved, with help of governments, but it will be led by a commercial entity.
Yeah. So these commercial parties, of course, that are Musk's Bezos, but yeah. So they want to make a two-way ticket as well, right?
You have to read between the lines, because Musk is saying that he wants to bring people back as well, but there is no capability there at the moment. So he's bringing people and a lot of equipment to Mars, but he doesn't talk anywhere about the return.
Okay.
So we heard that the issue is money. We already heard a little bit of how much it is. Can you, like, Eric, tell us what you consider the price of a ticket to Mars?
Ticket to Mars? I know the Mars One plan claims it's 6.8 billion euro. Governments indeed, it's in between 100 and 500 billion dollars. But yeah, personally, I think it can be done for, I would say, like 50. And one of the important things that need to change, again, has to do with risk and how you deal with it. But at this moment, sending astronauts in space, there is so much pressure to keep them alive. Of course, that's important, but almost to an extent that you say, is it worth that amount of money to bring the risk from 99.99% to 99.999%?
Do you maybe have an example to clarify that?
Well, for example, there is the old space shuttle program. Of course, we know that, for example, 1986 was an accident, the Challenger, actually caused by something which could have easily been prevented because the outer solid rocket boosters, they had a temperature crack in the rubbers. It could have been solved easily. So what they actually focused on is keeping the astronauts safe. And for example, in the first space flights, they had a very intricate system where the astronauts could leave the space shuttle during ascent. And that was a very complex door and complex parachutes and things they made for that. And it was only useful for 1 minute in flight. So they focused on a lot of things to make things very safe. But if you look at the big picture, they just made some simple things wrong. So you have to do, when you build these systems, you have to look at like the big picture and make sure that like it's solid. And especially for the space shuttle, this was not solid. There was some faults there. And I think overlooked by the fact that there were so much other things going on to make things safe for the astronaut that they overlooked that.
Right. So what we're saying a little bit is that we should better maybe assess the risks of space and maybe take a little bit more risks.
Take a little bit more risks. There's, I mean, for example, when the space shuttle had an accident, it was grounded for 2 years. And they built up again the new space shuttles and improved the new space shuttles. But yeah, you could easily say, well, let's just continue flying. Why not?
Do you think it's better to invest this money for problems on Earth instead of investing them in?
Yeah, that's always a interesting question to say, well, why shoot all these expensive rockets into space and, well, people have poverty here on Earth. But first of all, I never understand the connection why people bring that up. Because if you look at the problems we have here on Earth, like poverty, inequality, war, I totally agree, we should solve it. But I wonder if we now stop going to space and I give you, for example, the money that is now being put into sending people into space, and then say, here's the money, now solve your poverty problem, inequality. When will you solve it? Because I think these big problems we have on Earth, they need solving, but they need much bigger things to solve them. For example, the budget of the United States for civil space is about 0.5% of the total spending, where they spend about 25% into all kinds of war machines. So it's like saving room on your hard disk. You're not going to start with the little text files here and there. You find the big MPEG movies and you delete them.
So, and it's also unfair, right? Because we only get that question. It's only in space where we get these kind of questions. If you ask them for big metro subway lines, people never ask these kind of questions. So for me, it's also, there is some kind of a way that people think that going to space is a complete waste of money. Which, if you now look in society, how we're depending on what's being done in space, and I think that there's a nice a piece on the BBC website where they analyzed what would happen if all the satellites in Earth orbit would be dead tomorrow. And they basically calculate that within 3 days, whole society would collapse. Because the banking system is heavily dependent on the timing signals coming from the verification satellite. So there's a huge structure which is dependent. And it would never have been there if we would not have had space flight. Now you can of course discuss whether human space flight, but for me human space flight is all about trying to do stuff which is not possible before. Hey, you want to go out, you want to explore, you want to understand what kind of environment you're living in. And as I said before, for the long-term survival of humanity, it's really important to go out into space and to understand what's going on there, because it has a direct impact on life here on Earth.
Okay, I would like to suggest to see the questions from the audience.
Yes. Any questions?
Before we continue.
Do you see any danger in returning from Mars? If you bring people to Mars, I've just read a folder or an article that I published 20 years ago about the danger of going to Mars, and then if there's life on Mars, that will have effects that for instance, could bring back bacterial life that can have negative consequences for Earth. If you compare it to the Europeans going to America, they brought back all kinds of diseases, like the syphilis, but also they brought many diseases, like smallpox. It has been said that in Brazil, for instance, whole populations died out, probably because of the bacteria that the Europeans brought there. So. At that time, 20 years ago, people considered that a risk, if there's life on Mars, that it would, and you bring it back, that would have negative consequences, and now it seems all to have been forgotten. And while, in fact, the chance that there's life on Mars seems to increase all the time, if it would be announced today that people really found living organisms on Mars, no one would be really surprised. But the chance that it would have adverse consequences for Earth if you return, if you bring that life from Mars to Earth, that seems, somehow the whole question seems to have faded. So do we have any comments on that?
So the question is, is it? I think it's also a little bit of an ethical one, but if there's life on Mars,
of course. I understand. So there are two things here. First of all the missions which are currently going to Mars have to deal with the planetary protection rules which have been set up by COSPAR a long time ago. Now we also know that these rules are not able, we are not able to comply with those rules when you send humans there. So there needs already to be a discussion on how to make sure we end up with rules which protect life on Mars as much as we can, but still enable human exploration of the planet. For Mars 1, going back is not an issue because we don't provide that, so recontaminating Earth by bringing peace back. But we also have to be really aware of the fact that there is already a lot of exchange in the past between Earth and Mars by the exchange of rocks. So we know that there are lots of bacteria which are able to survive the trip between Earth and Mars. So bacterial exchange between Earth and Mars has already happened. And we have to assess whether life on Mars is really there. I don't think so, but you never know. But this will have an impact anyway. So when we are discussing landing sites, we always make sure that we don't pick these reserved places where potential possibility of life
arise there has been happening. So we don't want to go there. We want to stay as far away as possible from there to make sure that we don't contaminate that kind of life there. But there will be some kind of contamination anyway. So we have to make sure that we know what's happening. We will make sure that the risks, again, are made as low as possible. But there will be a risk.
I want to continue. We'll also focus a little bit more on this ethical questions later. But so what we talked about is we need to make space for AI cheaper, I guess, and maybe take a little bit more risk. Of course, all these commercial companies are working towards a cheaper space flight to make it also feasible for normal customers, I guess. So are these companies working together, or how's the competition between these companies? Because I can imagine that these technologies that we only this can only work if we work together, but I can also imagine that it's very competitive in a way.
First you have to understand that both Blue Origin of Jeff Bezos and SpaceX of Elon Musk, they work very closely together with the American government. Huh? So they have a huge contract in place to bring cargo to the ISS, and Musk's company is now also working on getting astronauts back to the ISS on an American vehicle. So there is already a large amount of collaboration between the companies and with the government, basically. But the difference with the past is now is that those companies get only paid once they deliver something. While in the past they were working on cost-plus contracts, where they were basically to spend endlessly without actually providing something. So this is the big change where SpaceX and Blue Origin come in. Now it's very important to have competition, because competition will give you these new innovative ways of going to space and also to lower cost. If you do not have competition, why would you lower the cost? Because you could ask whatever you want to bring stuff up to space.
My take on this is I have a hard time understanding how to do a commercial mission to Mars, real commercial, because I don't see going to Mars now benefit ultimately the end customer, like the consumer. And in the Mars One case, it's the business case is showing the mission on television and get all kinds of revenues from advertisement. And so if Elon Musk then says we're going to Mars and we're going to sell tickets at $200,000 a piece, he has to sell a lot of tickets. And I wonder if from this community that wants to go to Mars, and not everybody wants to go to Mars, from this community, if a large enough part of that community has this $200,000 in his or her bank account to go there, because that would be the commercial way. That's the advantage of governments. They can say we go there for science, we go for exploration, and we have money for it. Well, commercial companies, what's the business plan?
I think we have discussed a lot about how we are going together, but now I'd like to discuss if we're there, then there are also some problems. For instance, there is no oxygen, no water, and we cannot survive like we survive on Earth. How would we solve these problems?
Yeah, so on Mars, the temperatures are, during summer, during the day, they can be minus 10, minus 20. During winter they can be minus 60, and during the night they can go even lower. So it's pretty cold. But there is an atmosphere, lots of CO2 in the atmosphere, some very small portion of methane. Very interesting to think about the origin of the methane in the Martian atmosphere. Is that from a geological process or from a biological process? On Earth, I think 95% of the methane is from biological origin. So the fact that we see methane in the atmosphere of Mars could be biological. But also methane, you can extract it from the atmosphere and you have fuel, which you can burn. And if you burn that, you get CO2 again, but you also get water.
But I don't think the best way to get water is from burning the methane. There's a lot of water in the ground of Mars. And just that you need to dig, you need to heat it up and to extract the water. So so there is a power source, there is also the sun. You can use solar arrays, you have water in the ground. Yeah, there's all, I only need to start working there.
Once we get there, the making a colony self-sustaining won't be the most difficult part if you think about researches.
Yeah, that will be difficult. It sounds easy, okay, take the soil and heat it and get water. But you need to put it there, right? This whole equipment, you make it sustainable. If it breaks down, what do you do? You need redundancies, you need some good engineering to make it work. So that's not easy.
Arno, you said before that it's better to send first all the equipment and thereafter just the people, but how are we going to have this equipment there when there are no people to work with?
That's what we basically do now. Huh? We send these rovers there, we send the satellites there. They all work autonomously. And we only guide them in what they're actually doing. Some of the rovers on Mars now, we've got so much experience with it that they allow the rover to choose a bit of the path by himself. So there are lots of autonomous systems which are able to do that. Here on Earth, we look now into self-driving cars, all kinds of technologies which are basically aiming towards these autonomously operating systems. And this is what you definitely need on Mars. You need to show that your life support system on Mars is able to generate the oxygen and the water required for humans to survive. If you don't do that, you're not going to send people there. It's very simple, because the risks involved are too big.
And we mentioned oxygen, we mentioned water, we mentioned power, but of course something that's quite important for us is also food and agriculture, or in some way we need to get that. Are there ideas, are there studies that you know of that kind of show that this is possible on Mars, or is this also kind of a gamble of how we going to get food there?
We don't gamble with food, we bring food, very simple. So you bring for the first 4 or 5 years, you bring enough food so that people can survive. Secondly, what you do is that you start to do research, and also we already do it on Earth, where we try to understand how the Martian soil is working with respect to potatoes, tomatoes, and to see whether they're willing to grow in there. There's quite some study here, even here in the Netherlands, in Wageningen University, we're working on this, but also in NASA and in other places where people try to understand what kind of systems they need to be in place to make sure that you can really grow your own food. Because that's to make sure that you become self-sustaining, you need to live off the land. And this is the way you have to do it. So you have to find out what kind of vegetables are able to grow in Martian soil and stuff like that. But there are some positive signals that this is indeed possible. But then again, you have to make sure that people have enough to eat, so you bring food. And you don't just send them there and then you leave them. Eh? After a number of time, you bring an uncrewed cargo vessel with new supplies to make sure that people are able to survive. And people always say to me, well, it's really expensive to go to Mars. And yes, now it is. I completely agree. But once you're able to send people there, then the systems become cheaper and cheaper, and the uncrewed flight to Mars will become relatively cheap in the near future.
But why is that? Oh, because
you use the same systems, and it's not a one-off.
Yeah.
So you build many of those systems, and the more you build, the cheaper they will get.
So now you said it's always depending on Earth bringing stuff there. Do you think population on Mars, if there's going to be a population, is going to be anonymous, or can I live there without help of the Earth or without?
Not in the foreseeable future, no. Because there will be very complex equipment which you cannot make on Mars, like computer chips, and there are many, many more examples. So they will be dependent on flights from Earth. But I see it more as a two-way stream in the end. where people on Mars generate products and bring it to Earth, and the other way around. And look, in the long term, when you've got a sufficiently large population on Mars, you would like to see trades happening. There might be stuff which is quite unique on Mars, which is useful on Earth, and the other way around. Now I'm talking about a little bit more in the future, of course. But this is what, in the end, should happen. Yeah, you want to get some kind of mutual benefit from each other.
Do you agree on that?
I don't. The trade between Mars and Earth, I wonder what that could be. Yeah, some materials that we are not known to, but I couldn't think of one now. The only material that I know that could be valuable here on Earth is rhodium, which is a platinum group metal, which is very rare. There's maybe only 10,000 kilo per year that is being mined on Earth. So it's extremely expensive, more expensive than gold. But there's actually asteroids in the solar system flying out there, which have large chunks of this rhodium. So bringing that to Earth could be like a business case. But I don't see with Mars. What I know of Mars is that it's that there's rocks, so to speak, and a whole different rocks than here on Earth. But I wonder what you can do with those rocks on Earth. Of course, collectors would like to buy them.
Yeah, but I'm more talking more about, say, 100 years in the future. And I'm not talking about bringing rocks back to Earth. I'm talking more about art generated on Mars, stuff like that. Once you have a sufficiently large population on Mars, things will generate unique items which are worth bringing back to Earth. And it's not the way to finance a mission to Mars, not at all. This is just a consequence of having a population on Mars where you will probably see what's happening.
One important aspect, I think nuclear energy is also key to this new population on Mars to survive. You have to bring an efficient reactor to the surface of Mars would really make a huge difference.
Yes. So you need energy. You can either mine methane or you need a nuclear reactor. There's one also danger we maybe haven't talked about, because of course Mars doesn't have a magnetic field which on Earth protects us against the solar winds in a lot of cases. But since it isn't there, how can we protect ourselves from this quite damaging radiation that is bombarded on Mars?
If you walk around on Mars, I believe it's about the same radiation dose you get from actually living on the International Space Station. They are also outside of the Earth's atmosphere. There's more radiation there, so that's like similar. So you have astronauts survive there for 6 months, 1 year even. So it's possible to survive on Mars without really extreme shelter. But I would say if you're going there and put a colony there and really say, we're putting there some facilities for people to live the rest of their life there, I think they should find some nice caves in the mountains, that they go into the caves and by that have some thermal protection from the cold, but also protection from the radiation, the cosmic radiation and the radiation from the sun.
So it will be cavemen.
Cavemen, yes.
One other way of energy is solar panels. I just wondered, because the sun is not as, might be not even sufficient providing enough energy, do you think it's a way to use that kind of energy, because you mentioned it before, as a potential
Yeah, so you can use solar panels, but you have, you know, like you say, the sun, the Mars is about one and a half times more far away from the sun than Earth is. So that means one and a half squared the amount of light. So it will be like two times less bright during a bright day on Earth.
So there's less solar light, but you still can charge the batteries with solar panels. You just need larger solar panels. But yeah, if you can produce them on Mars, because the materials on Mars to make solar panels are there. You just need a machine to make the solar panels.
And okay, so we talked a little bit about surviving on Mars. You want to dig a little bit deeper into the consequences kind of a colony that it would have first on the humans that live there, but also more the society aspects of it. So first, maybe, are there ideas? Can everybody eventually go to Mars if we have to believe in Musk, or are there some kind of criteria that are important, especially for the first few flights? There will be a selection procedure. So how do we select the people that go?
Yeah, so I think if today you say, okay, I have a rocket and I go to Mars tomorrow, first of all, the government that you are that owns the land that you have your launch pad on, this government will need to sign off, allow you to launch. So first of all, this government can say, we don't want you to go to Mars. And then the government has all the right to stop you from launching to Mars. So in the end, it's a government, like what Arno said, there's restrictions. You just go where you want. And we see that also on Earth and on the borders, of course, that you cannot just go where you want. So this is also for Mars. But in the end, if you get the allowance from the government to go there, and you go there, and you set foot on Mars, and then you say, for example, an American astronaut says, this is now the United States of America. This astronaut can say that, but it's against the Outer Space Treaty.
Yeah.
Which states that all extraterrestrial bodies cannot be appropriated. They cannot be taken as land from a country.
Yes.
So as long as this astronaut, this crazy astronaut, will say this is United States of America, he's happy to do that. But when his boss, Donald Trump, will say, thank you for going to Mars, Mars is now
America. Yeah.
That's against the Outer Space Treaty. It's a theoretical question, what would happen then, of course.
So we want to get into that a little bit deeper, but I want to think about a little bit about the colony itself and the people there, because especially if you live there for a longer period of time, the culture will change, but also maybe eventually the humans itself, I mean, they live in different conditions. For example, have people thought about what the effect will be on the bones or on the body because of the lower gravity, for example? Will people eventually be able to come back at all? Because maybe they can't handle Earth's gravity or other stuff like that.
Yeah, so you have on Mars, it's one-third. Yeah. Mars is actually only a small planet. It's just bigger than the Moon. So it's in between the Moon and the Earth, but more towards the Moon. That's one-third. So saying you live on Mars for 10 years, and you say, I want to go back to Earth. And you fly back to Earth, and you suddenly get three times more the force on your body, I think you will die.
Have you thought about that, Arno?
As we said, we don't care. We don't go back. So that's a very simple answer. But there are many other things which will happen in the long term with humans on the surface of Mars. Because there is lower gravity, you will see that people will become taller. A very simple consequence of being in a low gravity field. And you will also see that people will start to get systems in their body which will protect them from radiation. This is a natural flow of evolution. So this will happen. And how this will happen, we have no clue. We don't know. But this slowly but certainly will become part of humans there. And when people really want to come back, you have to have technological assistance to ensure that you're able to do that. But I wonder whether people really want to. So they go there for a reason.
But can you, if they really change a lot, when do you stop calling them humans? I mean, if they, I mean, top hundreds of years. I mean, the evolution goes on. If they are, if you can't call them humans at a certain point, what's the point of expanding the human race, kind of?
Because it doesn't matter. It's not expanding humans only. It's expanding life. That's what you're doing. And there will always be a connection with humans on Earth, even though they have physically changed. What I would also expect that from just the culture will be completely different from what you hear everywhere on Earth.
Yeah.
But for me, that's a richness. You increase the richness in human society by having humans from all kinds of different places, live differently, develop culturally completely different. That's for me one of the key essences of being a human, to understand that and to learn from that. That will only enrich us in the end.
Okay.
I wondered if this population on Mars is there. Do you think they will have a society like ours?
What rules will they follow? Are there rules on Mars?
Who's going to determine the topic? Because I would guess that humans on Earth, sending humans to Mars, they will somehow say, yeah, let's think about a set of rules for you. Once you get to Mars, you have to live by those rules and derive that from the rules we have here on Earth. But in the end, I think that's not what's going to happen, because these people that are going to Mars, if they're not going back, they will make their own rules. They will say, yeah, well, we are now here. Thanks for the rules you put on us, but who cares? We are now here, we can make our own rules.
Do you think of Mars like a kind of utopia world then?
As an utopia, I hope to think so. This becomes a society with no wars, no injustice, and no inequalities.
Yeah, but the problem is you bring humans there, and within the human character, all these flaws are enclosed. So the idea that bringing people to Mars will set up a utopian society is completely flawed, because you will have people there who will get angry, who will start a war, and will kill other people. This is just the way humans behave at the moment. We have not transcended to some higher conscience or whatever, where we have a utopian world. So changing planets will not change that.
But is that then, that's like, for me, an ethical question. Are we going to send humans to Mars with the risk that they will extinct us back on Earth? Because they evolve to a society much more advanced, and they will see us as like a limited species back here on Earth. And they say, yeah, these are dangerous creatures.
Yeah, but now you're talking maybe 1,000, 2,000 years in the future. By then, I hope that we will have expanded other places in the solar system as well. So, from my point of view, every place in the solar system you can live on has always a direct need of resources from other places, like water, which is a key essential in the solar system. So you will depend on trade and other systems and other parts to sustain yourself. And don't get me wrong, I do think that when you look far in the future, that you will see conflicts in space, like you have now conflicts on Earth. I don't see any other possibility, because that's just the way humans are. I just hope that we become a little bit more smarter the next 2,000 years to try to avoid these mistakes as much as we can. But they will happen, no doubt.
Okay, very interesting. All we can do is wait. It's important to think about it, of course. So, what do you think? When will the first man actually stand on Mars?
Around
2032,
2033. You say man, I think a woman.
Yeah.
A woman will land on Mars in 2043.
Alright, interesting. Most of us will live to see it, if your predictions are correct. I think maybe some questions from the audience to Red, in the back, or cameraman.
Hey, we spoke a little bit about governmental resistance in risk-taking, and maybe you already touched upon this subject, but then I just missed it. risk-taking if you behave, if you operate within the law in a commercial way, then risk-taking is kind of a non-issue, right? Because governmental resistance then isn't, it's kind of out of the question. I mean, look at, we put David Baumgartner in space with his balloon with Red Bull and let him jump out, which was a pretty big risk. And everybody seemed pretty happy to see that.
Yeah, but he still had to abide to the rules from a government. Huh? He was not able to just go up. And the preparations for doing this took 4 to 5 years. So, and there was lots of law issues involved as well.
Mm-hmm.
Because if he would have died, then there were some repercussions on the land where he was basically flying from. So then he had to be abiding a lot of rules. And what with risk taking, what I mean is that you don't, like Eric said, you don't want to go for 100% safe system.
No.
You have to go back to, say, 91-92%, allowing for some risks which you know there are there, you calculate them, but you say, okay, the chances of happening are such that either we expect them to happen only once every so many flights, or there are systems in place where we could mitigate the effects of the risk you take.
Yeah, right. Because as you mentioned,
you have some problems.
Because costs increase exponentially with increased risk, right? That's the reason.
Right. Okay, then we'd like to have our final question. We already slightly discussed it, but if we then go to Mars tomorrow, would you go?
Never mind. If you would have asked me 10 years ago, I would have said yes. Now I have two small kids, so the answer is no. If you ask me again in 10 years, maybe 20 years, I would say yes again.
What about you?
I also have two kids, but I would go, but I would like to have a return trip. So I want to go back again.
But if there's no return trip, if there wouldn't be a return, you wouldn't go. So if you could not go back, then you wouldn't go?
I would not go if I could not come back.
Yeah. Never? Even not in the future?
No, maybe in the future, like if I know, for example, that I have like a few years to live, then yeah, I could think to go for a one-way trip. Yeah.
That's a hope that will be possible. I want to thank our speakers, please keep the class for our speakers. Thank you to the public for joining us for the last Bad Break of the Year. We start again in September, and we are looking for new members for our committee. So if you're interested, you can email us with the motivation, and then we might reply to your request. Thank you very much for coming, and see you in September.